everybody, your friendly neighborhood restorer here, Caleb. So this week, more bathroom stuff, but a little bit different bathroom stuff because I've been working on the beadboard, or I'm about to anyway, so you guys will be seeing that. And I hope to be able to share with you guys a few kind of how I do what I do tips this week as well. So we're going to be talking about how I'm putting on the beadboard and how I plan on doing the plaster and electrical as well. So I want to just kind of show you a little bit, kind of a peek into what actually occurs when I do half of these things. So let's get into that. So first thing of note is the floor in here, which is a self-leveled poured concrete floor. I put it on top of the plywood. Covers up a lot of holes and also levels out the floor, so the tile, when I put it down, will be fairly close to level. It's almost perfect. I think between here and there, it drops, an eighth of an inch. So nothing really to be concerned about. So happy enough with it. It looks pretty good. It feels pretty good. It's gone under the foot and all that, so happy there. You can see me starting to lay out the beadboard to go up, and I've got my line marked here. That is a level line, so I've measured over here, started from this corner, found the measurement I wanted to have, and then I've been drawing the line all the way around. And then hopefully we'll be able to tack at least this wall with beadboard today. And you might also notice, as people had recommended, and I was always going to do, but you know, you guys don't know until you know, this is my rock wool insulation. I've got it up in the ceiling in the library and some other spots, and I've been filling in these places too. Because of, yes, anything that's open, guys, that I open up anywhere in the house, will always get insulation put in it. This room, for the obvious reason of more soundproofing than actually keeping this room warm. This room doesn't have a heat source, nor probably will it ever. Basically, with the two windows, these windows and the other ones on the other side of the room, and the door open probably more than it will be closed, this room will just be heated and cooled by the surrounding vents and other rooms that are right here next to it, the hallway. So yeah, should be fairly easy there. After we get a bit of this beadboard up, because we're going to go into a time lapse of me working on this stuff, then I'm going to show you guys how to do a bit of plastering with Structolite, because I know a lot of people have been asking to explain a bit more of what I'm doing, so I'll explain a bit more of what's going on there. Also, I know a few of you guys asked, I did use glue on this, that's how you get that to stick on that. You can use plaster weld, I use the cement glue that I have, it works fine. From what I've heard, there's not a huge amount of difference between the two, at least in how they operate. So, the plaster stuck just fine. I had zero problems with it. So, yeah, we should be good there. Okay guys, so for that plaster tutorial I promised you guys, let's go ahead and get it. So first off, gotta get some plaster. What I'm using is a gypsum based plaster. It's called Structolite. You can get it pretty much at any big box store. A lot of people sell it. It's pretty common. It is gypsum based. It is not great for water, and I wouldn't use it on exterior walls that are brick. If you have wooden walls that you're going to insulate, fine. But if your wall needs to breathe or, you know, move moisture, don't use this stuff. It's not for it. It's not for exterior stuff. It's not for anything that handles a lot of water. Yes, I understand we're in a bathroom, but this is also not a bathroom that will have a bath or a shower, which is why I feel comfortable using it in here. So let me grab a scoop of it. We'll get to it. So here is our plaster. You can see it sticks to the tile pretty good. It's kind of got like a, let's say, a pudding consistency to it. And it's just mixed up. This is a hawk. This is a trowel. And essentially what you're going to do is try to, with your wrist, push up, get a little bit of the plaster on your trowel, like so. And then this wall has already been pre-wetted down. And then we're just going to push it in there. I like to start from the inside corner. Obviously this is an inside corner. This is an outside corner. I like to start this way and push over. And actually this corner here, from here down, this is a bit low. So I'm going to leave a little extra material in there. The first pass, you don't really have to worry about getting anything necessarily perfect. You're just trying to fill in the low areas and kind of gloss over the highs. Get another scoop. Basically, all the control for you furring it out is all in the wrist. So you can see I either tilt it this way, or I push a little harder, or I push a little less. And that's how you can kind of move material around. And basically, all you're trying to do is get a semi-flat surface. Not a perfect surface, just sort of nice. Because this isn't a finishing plaster. I'll have to discuss that next week. If you guys are doing this, make sure you do wet your wall beforehand. Your plaster will crack because if it doesn't have enough moisture, because all it will do is the layer behind it will suck all the moisture content out of it, and it will crack this new top layer. And that's something you want to avoid. So make sure you're definitely wetting down the wall quite a bit. I use a Hudson sprayer, as you can see in the time lapse. No trick to it, just pure water in there. If you do have something that's a painted surface or like the drywall, you do have to use a concrete adhesive or something like plaster weld, which I'm not exactly sure where to get that because I don't typically use it. And that's only just because ease of access is why I use the concrete stuff, because you can pick it up at Lowe's, which is where I normally shop. So. Kind of the same thing on the outer corner. Just load some up on the one edge. You want to keep trying to cleaning that edge up too, because you'll end up with little hang-ons like this on the edge. And ideally you don't want those. So that was a bit of a mistake by me, but you can always come back and hit it again. With this stuff, you typically have about I'd say 2-ish hours to kind of play with it a little bit. Of course, it will harden up a little bit in that time, but I would say, yeah, no more than really 2 hours, and then it's pretty hard and it doesn't want to move any longer. So that's about the time you got to play with it. And if you are doing something, you know, if you're doing this in an area you don't want to get messy, obviously use a drop cloth. You know, it's easier to clean up a drop cloth and just kind of, or a piece of plastic and just throw it away than it is to scrub your floor again. Depending on what room I'm doing, when I'm doing it, I will use a drop cloth. Other times I have not. But that's just probably me being a bit silly and a bit foolish. What I'm doing here is keeping the trowel pretty flat to the surface, just slightly with the edge up, and just going very lightly over it. Just kind of trying to brush out a lot of these working marks. That gets most of that out of there. And then, just for demonstration purposes, usually I'd wait about an hour or two to do this, but this is what's called a pull trowel. You can see it has rounded edges on it. And essentially what I'll do is I'll float this out with this. So any of these lines or these imperfections, especially after it's had about an hour to sit, you can usually work them out pretty well, get this pretty flat with this. You can use a lot more pressure, especially when it's starting to get dry with this tool, and get a much better looking product. So, you see, even though it hasn't dried all the way, it still allows me to pull a lot of the stuff out without leaving those lines you saw before. Now, I wouldn't say this piece is as crucial for the what's called the rough layers, so your first two layers of plaster. When you put it on the veneer coat, this is an absolute must, in my opinion, anyways. So I hope you guys enjoyed that little tiny baby bit of what I have to do to get this stuff on and kind of what the process is. I know a lot of people have called for, hey, give us an explanation of what's going on. And I've just now got to the point where I feel comfortable doing that, because I've been doing enough plaster at this point that I feel like I could share some of what I've learned with you guys. When I first started doing plaster, I didn't want to give you guys bad information. And I had made tons of mistakes to get to this point where I feel somewhat comfortable. That being said, with all of this information I just shared with you guys, this is my approach to it. I am no master. I've only been doing this for a few months, realistically. But, you know, I feel comfortable enough now in what I'm doing. You know, most everything's been a success so far. So I feel like I've got enough information to share with you guys. And at least, you know, if I did something wrong, maybe you guys can point it out to me. So I hope you guys enjoyed the new little segment, I suppose. I'll see about doing more of these as I do different projects, so. All right, guys, so let's show you what I got done this week. Some pretty good stuff, and I'm starting to see, really, really see the end of the road here, so I think it's getting pretty exciting. Here's that wall I was plastering. You can see it's not perfectly flat. Obviously, there's little divots and stuff like that, but I never really worry about things small like that, because on this finished layer, when you go over it, that's not something that the veneer plaster can't handle, and it's actually a good grip point for it. So little thing, imperfections like that I try to keep in. It's bigger lines and gouges I try to keep it or get out. But basically this wall's pretty much ready to go. Of course, it's still wet right now, but as soon as it dries, it'll be ready to go, and we'll put it all back together. And pretty much that is the last wall to go. And next week, for sure, we will be getting into the veneer coat, because the veneer coats when all the walls start being very pretty and perfect, and it definitely means now that I need to go ahead and order my paint. So yeah, tomorrow will probably be paint ordering day. So that means tomorrow will be the decision to figure out what color the base color of that old wallpaper will be. Looking into it, I think it might be just a bit more yellow than what I have right now. So like a yellowy sand beige color, somewhere around there, and then a more of like a terracotta red for the actual pattern on the wallpaper. But I think that's going to be a super fun project. I hope you guys think so too, because yeah, it'll just be good, a little bit of a change of pace, and you know, once you have some decoration back in one room, I think it will fuel the fire again a little bit for me. Not that I've really necessarily need that. I've been going pretty strong, so that's good. But of course, plaster was not the only thing that went down this week. We also have this beadboard. Now, you may notice that this beadboard is different than this beadboard in color. And that's because there's already shellac on this. I was just testing it to see the color of it. It is quite dark, but then again, so is most of the woodwork in here, but there's still a nice, beautiful red to it. For whatever reason, this stuff, like this piece here, has like 8 coats of shellac on it, and it does not want to go glossy. But I'm not terribly worried about that because shellac will not be the final coat. I'm going to order a product called Waterlocks, and I'm actually going to seal all of this with Waterlocks. So I'm hoping to get like a satin finish for that, so it has some shine like shellac would, but it will keep everything watertight. And I can do that because this shellac that's on these is what's called a de-waxed shellac. So there's no wax in it. They take they separate the wax out when they, you know, put these flakes together. That way something will stick on top of it. So if I had wax in this, another coating like Waterlocks or polyurethane or whatever you'd want to use would not actually stick to this very well. So to get a good bond, use de-wax stuff. I do it anyways because with a lot of the other stuff you saw me wax other things. I will have to, these are actually copper studs here, so they have some plaster on them, but those will be fixed pretty easily. And obviously the holes will be covered by, well, I don't know, flanges, I guess would be the correct word. This will probably have to be cut back ever so slightly, and then I'm going to get a, well, brass-looking tube, I suppose, for that, or copper-looking tube. But it will probably be steel, but, you know, coated or something, plated. And that will go there. Shouldn't be too much of a problem. And then, yeah, you can see the insulation, the rock wool. And this is the beadboard that I'm actually using a bit closer up for you guys. Like with everything, it's reclaimed material. So lots of little nails, and there's actually little remnants of wallpaper on some of these pieces. I mean, very, very small. Like, you couldn't see the pattern anymore, so it wasn't necessarily worth showing you guys because it was just paper or sometimes a little bit of canvas at the bottom. But as it stands right now, I actually don't have enough of this stuff. So I'm hoping to be able to find some of this stuff here soon because I can do about half of the bathroom with what I have now. So we're going to have to figure that out. So that's fun. Also, I did want to show you guys this as well. This is the trim or the cap, as I keep calling it, for the beadboard. So this will go on top. Now, of course, this is painted. It will be stripped and shellacked and water locks just like the beadboard itself. But this here actually, when I don't know how this ended up here necessarily, but it was actually used as trim in the door. But this is the exact same mold profile as the stuff in the kitchen that goes around the top of the beadboard, the cap, and in the bathroom on the second floor. So I'm actually going to be using mostly the stuff that was in this room from the door frame and then stealing a little bit from the kitchen because most of the stuff in the kitchen has to be remade anyways. So, you know, steal from there to bring to here because there's enough to do this bathroom, but not enough to do the kitchen. But I think the way that looks is pretty awesome. So quite happy with that. Can't wait to get all the color on there. When that red starts shining through, I think it's going to be beautiful. And then I know one last thing I know you guys keep talking about is how are you going to light this place? Well, I think the most conventional method would be to put a hole up there and run an outlet and a chandelier. I'm not going to do that. There's no evidence of a chandelier being there ever. And most of the smaller rooms like this didn't actually have lights from the ceiling. They actually had sconces. So I'm going to be putting sconces in here. So right before I do this last layer of the veneer layer, I'm going to take a hole saw and cut a hole through here. I have to measure out my sink, of course, because I want it to be directly between the sink and the toilet, which will be right here. So between these two items, I'm going to put a sconce that will come off. It will be a half gas, half electric. I have two of them. And the other one, if I flip around, there's the window to the stairwell. The main stairs are right above us and the door is right here. I'm going to be putting the other one right here, or here-ish, basically. So you'll have one right across from the sink and then one right next to it, or between the sink and the toilet. And the light switch will be going here. Now you might be asking yourself, Caleb, why would you wait to put these in? Well, simply put, it's easier kind of to cut into the plaster from this angle. And I'm going to be using what's called old work boxes for the sconce and for the light switch. Essentially, they have little wings that fold out behind it and you screw it together and it grabs the wall. For me, that was a better way to go because you never know exactly how thick you're gonna have to make this stuff. And if you nail a box into here, you might have to use extensions and some other stuff. So for me, it's actually easier to go this route with it. That won't be how I do all the boxes in the house. I mean, obviously I haven't done all the boxes in the house like that, but especially with the sconces, because they're such perfect little circles, it's easier to let this all kind of be instead of trying to sculpt around it. So that's why you haven't seen me do any electrical yet. Obviously, this is still open. It's very easy to run lines down through here. And there's no fire block till about up here. So no worries there. I won't have to drill through the fire block. And for those who don't know, the fire block is just a block that goes between the upright beams of a wall to stop fire from burning further up, or to at least slow the burning fire from going further up faster. So that's, you know, kind of a no-no. It's a hard thing to get to if you have to drill through that first. However, you know, shouldn't be too hard there. The only other electric in here is, of course, this sconce. Again, this wall in the back in the kitchen is completely open because there used to be a doorway here. So it'll be very, very easy to get to this sconce here. No problem there at all. And then the last thing that has to happen is one outlet, which will actually be here under the sink. Now, of course, anybody who's saying you can't have an outlet under a sink, you can actually have a GFCI outlet underneath the sink. That's what most people's garbage disposals are plugged into. So I'll be cutting a hole here and again running an old work box back here and pushing it directly flush with the beadboard, which is why it isn't in yet, because I wanted the beadboard to be in first to make sure it's flush. Because I have access to the back of the wall, that's a really easy thing to do. And then I get a perfect hole. So that's the plan with that. I mean, honestly, if I could, I would have done the pipes that way, but you know, I just had to do a little bit of extra measuring and stuff to make sure the pipes went through the correct way. But I think those holes are pretty snug. You know, obviously you have to have a little cap to cap those off so you don't see the holes in the beadboard, but I think it looks pretty good. So yeah, things are starting to move along. We're starting to have a room. I mean, this is definitely a far cry from what we started with. You know, all the tile floor and the bathtub and the vitrolite tile, and I mean, there was a lot that's been done here, you know, so, and everything takes time because most everything I'm using here is reclaimed material. Each piece of beadboard takes about 30, 40 minutes for me to clean up, you know, sand it down, get in the groove, sand it down. And that's just luckily because I don't have any paint on it. If they had paint, a few hours each one. So, you know, using reclaimed materials is harder for sure, but you know, you get a better result in my opinion. There's dings and there's life that's already been lived in this material. And I think you get such a better feel and look with it. It doesn't feel fake. It's real because it is real. That and, you know, good luck trying to find a beadboard with, or you know, modern beadboard or modern lumber with such tight grains like the old stuff, so. So that's going to do it for us this week. I hope for another spectacular week next week with a lot more work done. I'm going to start trying to stay up here more often. For those who don't know, I did spend my first night up here this week, so that's super fun. Expect a video Thursday on that and all the snow and all the fun stuff in that direction. Thank you guys, as always, so much for being here and supporting Kim and I. It's been a lot of fun, and I hope you guys are having a lot of fun. So have a wonderful, wonderful rest of your week, and we'll see you guys next week.